Thank you so much. Great event. I want to thank the dean and members of his faculty for extending this invitation to me. This is a rare honor and privilege that I will cherish forever. My great, wonderful students of IFE, I greet you all. I want to thank you for your patience. I'm aware you have been here for a very, very long time. And I appreciate, thank you. I appreciate you all for coming. I thank you all for your patience and your understanding. I don't take that for granted. And that's why I'm not going to read any long lectures, as it were, as I would have rather loved to do. I will summarize my thoughts and my perspectives on this great burning issue of our country that is going on now. Perspectives that are not entirely new, but which I would like to restate for emphasis, and also to provoke our thoughts, provoke each and every one of us to think of what we should do by way of contributing ideas as to how we can recreate a stable and prosperous and safe country. I never had the opportunity of attending this great university as I would have loved to do when I was younger. And so I congratulate you all, and appreciate the dreams of the founding fathers of this great university. I appreciate the work of generations of school administrators who have, by their sweat and by tears, turn this university to be one of the foremost citadels of learning, not only in our country, but in our continent and around the world. So I congratulate you all. Congratulate you all. Now, as a result of this visit and this interaction today, I believe that at the end of today, I should qualify somewhat to refer to myself also as an alumni of this great institution. Now, let me go straight to the points I've come here to make. The subject matter of restructuring is no other than a call to re-examine the founding principles of our nation. It's a call to go back to the founding principles agreed upon by the founding fathers of our nation. You are well aware of the history of our country. And this being a faculty of arts, I assume you all know some of these basic facts about the history of our nation. First, that this country started off as a body of separate and disparate kingdoms and clans and entities and city-states, that some of them were perpetually at war, and for centuries we existed, coexisted also, until the British came, the Portuguese and the British came at different times, and one thing leading to another, saw it fit for their own benefit initially to bring these desperate different peoples and kingdoms together. They did that employing different means, sometimes by conquest, and most of the time by conquest, and sometimes by subtle persuasion. So with the aid of their guns and magazines, and aided by the gospel also, they traversed the nooks and crannies of what has become modern Nigeria. And kingdoms after kingdoms started falling to the superior firepower and organizational confidence of the foreign invaders and settlers. This country essentially was an economic enterprise. You will be surprised to know that at any time, even when we transited from colony and protectorate and then to United Nigeria, 1914, a number of you may not know that each time the Governor General of Nigeria traveled, was on leave, the head or chairman of USC, the British trading conglomerate, acted as Governor General of Nigeria. That will let you know the convergence between trade and commerce and colonial exploits that eventually laid the foundations of present-day Nigeria. And that's why you may have heard our revered, one of our revered nationalists and founding fathers, whose name is immortalized in this university, Chief Obafemi Awolowo of blessed memory, in his books, referred to our country as a geographical expression. Now, he was not wrong. He was not wrong. And let me say this. Every nation on the face of the earth is a geographical expression. The reason Awolowo was right, and is right all the time, right today, about Nigeria, is that Nigeria is a work in progress. It's a work in progress. Our founding fathers never assumed the unity of this country. They negotiated and discussed the terms of our union. You may have also heard of a statement credited to another founding father, this time the Prince of the Caliphate, Sir Ahmadu Bello, when he addressed his contemporaries in their several meetings, both in Nigeria and outside, and said, gentlemen, wait a minute, the idea of Nigeria is good, we've all agreed on that, but let us start by noting and understanding our differences. That was the mindset with which our founding fathers approached the issue of founding a new Nigeria as conceived, not by them, but by the British. And so began a series of constitutional conferences. You will read in the textbooks about the various constitutional conferences in Nigeria and also in the colonial offices. But in addition to that, there were several informal contracts and engagements to craft the foundation upon which this new Nigeria was going to be built. And that was why the issue of federalism came in. And our departed leader and father, whose name is immortalized in this institution, is clearly the foremost federalist. He was the foremost federalist of his time, and perhaps one of the greatest and most profound federalist scholars and thinkers of our country. And in 1954, they all arrived at a consensus to say, yes, the idea of Nigeria is reasonable, but then understanding and recognizing our differences, and yet being in a big entity with all the advantages that come with it, let us devise a federal system of government. And that was what they worked on. This institution, this great institution, is a standing, timeless memorial to the potentials of a properly structured federal system. The three leading institutions that were built, which up till today are foremost in our country, the Bafame Awolowo University, this great university, starting 1961-62, Amadu Bello University, and later the University of Nigeria and Soka. All these were regional efforts. All these were regional efforts. And all the wonderful exploits that our leaders at the time did in their various regions are attributable to proper management of regional resources as a result of the unleashed potential of a federal Nigeria. Now, you will realize that along the line, things went wrong. Things went wrong in several ways. Things went wrong when in 1966, the military came in and discarded the federal structure, which was a fundamental founding principle of our nation. And they made decrees after decrees, centralizing Ironsi, Piku, which Ironsi himself announced a unification decree. And even those who did a counter coup and, you know, pushed aside that government in a bloody manner, didn't discard the unification principle that they said they were not accepting. And you all know how we went into a needless conflict. The efforts at Aburi Conference was not just an attempt at battle war, it was also another constitutional conference in its own sense. Because there at that time, then Colonel Ojukwu, leader of the Eastern region at the time, later Biafra, tabled the issue not of federalism, but of confederation. And there were disagreements, and we went into a needless conflict that turned brothers against brothers, all because of the violation of the federal principle. And government after government, military administration after military administration, kept shunning out decrees not made by our people, not accepted by our people. A number of them not even known to our people, except a few lawyers. And they wrote constitution after constitution, consolidating their centralized ideas about governments, which were actually a mirror of military command and control. And all this went on up to 1978-79, when the military handed us a constitution that was in every sense a decree. Our people, yes, there was a constitutional conference, but then the military leadership at the time favored a system of government that we had not experimented before, threw away our parliamentary system that had produced all of these developments, cheap to run, easy to check abuse of power, and all of that, threw it away, and again brought another centralized idea as to how our country should be run, i.e. presidentialism. And that is where we are today. Since then, military government after military government came with decrees splitting our country from four regions. You know, we started with three regions. The only region, the only exercise as civilians, midwives, in terms of reorganizing our country was the 1963 effort to establish the Midwestern region. All others are products of military decrees, military dictatorship. And so from 12 states to 19, and thereon, going on till now, 36 states. But all of this has still not addressed the federal question. And why federalism? Why federalism? For a country as diverse, I've said that you must understand in this country that were essentially a collection of different tribes and kingdoms and clans that existed for long, for centuries, before the Portuguese and the British and everyone else came. And that was why Sadana kept warning, we cannot gloss over our differences, be they cultural, be they religious, be they social, because those are essentially what makes us a people. If you remove Yorubanness from a Yoruba man, he cannot be a good Nigerian. But what we need to strive for is how we can be good Nigerians, but also be who we are. And that was what the First Republic original founding fathers built on. But the military people who came for different ideas now introduced a system we're not used to. And in addition to being in control, running a centralized military chain of command and transporting that to governance, and making that as a model in terms of the structures of our country, what they did was to ignore our basic and essential differences. Now let me make it clear, these differences are not inimical to the Nigerian idea. They are not. If you go to China, the most populous nation on the planet, the largest tribe there, the Han, the Mandarin is a tribe, is a language, is a dialect of the Han people. But that's the official language. They all speak it. But they've evolved a system of inclusivity and productivity, and progressively building on an idea of a Chinese nation. And that's why Oluwa was right then and is right today when he said our nation and every nation is essentially a geographic expression. It is left for the leadership, it is left for the people to craft a system that best suits them. Every nation is a work in progress. So when we talk about differences, when Sadana talks about differences, understanding differences, he didn't discount the idea of a united, strong, indissoluble Nigerian nation. No. Every nation is an artificial creation. Look at the United States. A nation of immigrants. Of, let me say, a nation of where everybody went there and called it home. Until now, that in the era of Trump, there is a definition as to who an American citizen is. But that's a healthy conversation that is going on there. If you look at all the countries, they're all like that. After all, before the British came, we hardly ever even had monolithic tribes, as you call it. There was nothing like a united Yoruba nation in the Southwest. No. What you now call as the Southwest, again, was a combination of different clans and kingdoms. Some understanding and sharing the same languages and dialects, but then also retaining some measure of autonomy and an idea, a federal idea in them. My great-grandmother is from Ijebu. She was a princess of Ijebu. So I'm a young grandma. A doctor, she was a princess, a doctor of the Abujali at the time. Her own elder brothers became Abujali after her father. So I come from a very prominent ruling house, the people that ruling house of Ijebu. So I'm proudly Yoruba, as I'm proudly John, as I'm proudly Nigerian. So the point we are making is, and this is not just about Yoruba land, as we now call it. In Ife, you don't need to look too far from here to know the historic challenges that our people have dealt with over time. And that applies to the Southeast. There was no united people, no united people nation, no. In my own part, the Niger Delta, We have made our sacral, littoral city-states that have always been independent, self-sustaining, in other words, federal systems operating. And if you go to the north, from the separate tribes and chiefdoms in the middle belt, what we now call the middle belt, up to even the north, there were kingdoms, predominantly Hausa states, ruled by Hausa kings and princes, until another cataclysmic event, the Jihad of 1804, came and changed the history of that part of our country. But that's not what I'm talking about today. What I'm saying essentially is that our leaders were right when they agreed on federalism as the ideal system of government or structure of government for our country. A system that allowed them autonomy to organize themselves in view of our differences, cultural, social, religious, which are legitimate and which should never be discounted. But also allowed them to propound and build on the greater Nigerian dream, which remains desirable today. And every nation is like that. In Ghana, the same thing. But I think one of the things, the ills that have befallen us, is that instead of working from our tribal positions, our positions of comfort, and projecting an overarching national identity, a national ideal, and aspiration. I'm told my brother Iroko is in the hall. You're welcome. Thank you very much for coming. This is a course we have shared together. So, the tragedy that has befallen our country is that we have not been able to do what the Chinese have done. We've not been able to do what the Americans have done, sinking these disparate identities to build a greater national identity. That is what has happened. And the other reason, federalism, it was very convenient for people, especially the military, to throw away the federal foundation that our leaders agreed upon, was the discovery of oil in my state of Biafra, in a place called Uribe, in 1956-58. That made it convenient. And people saw the oil resources there as money that can be used to develop everybody else, and most of the times to the detriment of the people that produce it. So we move from Nigeria being conceived initially as a colonial British commercial enterprise, and now with the discovery of oil, with the military imposed federal systems, the resources of the part of the country were now seen as resources of the whole country. So the only difference was that legislation that bore the name of the Queen were replaced with an entity known as the Federal Republic of Nigeria. And what a contradiction! Our name still remains the Federal Republic of Nigeria. But we are not federal except in name. We are one of the most centralized countries. And this is why there has been so much unhealthy competition and rivalry and crisis at the federal level. So, what do we mean when we say restructuring? I am aware that several people have several ideas and notions about what a restructured Nigeria should mean. And that there's nothing wrong with that. Because this is a healthy debate that we should have in this country. The only difference is that whereas the founding fathers who crafted the foundations of our country had the patience and the skills to listen to one another, to agree and disagree, here, that opportunity has been lost since the military came in. Even on the issue of what kind of policing system should we have in Nigeria, Our leaders, founding fathers, our fathers took time to debate. Took time on every issue. On independence. They took time to debate. When they saw that the Lord was not ready, they gave in. I said, okay, we do our self-governance, we allow you time to prepare. That spirit of interaction, engagement has been lost. And now people sit down in their comfort zones and call others names, stereotypes, and then without even interrogating the substance of what people are talking about, they dismiss it and even indulge in what in the American political dictionary has become known as McCarthyism. There was a very prominent senator in America, Senator McCarthy, in the heydays of communism and the crisis of the world order, who had a penchant for pointing accusing fingers at opponents and questioning their patriotism and commitment. And that's why recently, when everyone in this country is talking about the need to restructure our country, our president, President Muhammadu Buhari, made a statement that is not only wrong, but a statement that is faulty, a statement that cannot stand the test of time, a statement that in itself is a threat to the continued stability and prosperity and development of our country. When it dismissed outright the notion of restructuring. And it didn't stop there, it went ahead to say that those who are in support of restructuring are doing so for a parochial agenda. Mr. President, you are wrong. Those of us, the majority of Nigerians, from the north, from the south, from everywhere, from the west, from the east, from the middle belt, the majority of Nigerians who are talking about restructuring, who are arguing, making a case for the need to restructure our country, are indeed the patriots of our country. Those of us talking about restructuring want a stable Nigeria. A Nigeria that works. Is Nigeria working now? We want a Nigeria that works. We don't want a Nigeria that you think from your comfort zone has conferred unfair advantages on people. And you think that the best thing to do is to maintain those unfair advantages. We want a Nigeria of equal citizenship. A Nigeria for the big as well as the small. A Nigeria for the many as well as the few. A Nigeria that can protect its people. A Nigeria that we Nigerians will be proud to come home any day. With an equal stake that we can proudly pledge allegiance to. That is the Nigeria we are seeking. No one is talking about the corporate existence of Nigeria. And let me make it clear again and again. The call for restructuring is not about dismemberment of our nation. All of us want a big, strong Nigeria. But we must re-examine the foundations of that Nigeria. And from the ashes of the old, create a Nigeria of the future. In the next couple of years, my dear friends, this country will be one of the most populous nations in the world. Yes. And if we want a Nigeria that can stand up, if we want a Nigeria that the black man can be proud of, a Nigeria that will be able to project its potential, achieve and project its potentials, a Nigeria that will not continue to be a nation of potentials that are not achieved. If we don't want a Nigeria of perpetual division and rancor and agitation. Then the way to go is restructuring. It's a call for a reform to true federalism. And I've always asked that the president should lead this important national initiative. In the last couple of days and weeks and months, I have interacted with a lot of people, a lot of leaders, Nigerians from all walks of life, even across the political divide. And why do I do that? I believe we should engage and explain what we mean one to the other. We don't all have to agree, but whether we agree or disagree, let us engage, and by so doing, break down the barriers of miscommunication and distrust. And I can report to Nigerians that the outcome of my interactions across the length and breadth of our nation shows that Nigerians are overwhelmingly in support of restructuring. We are for a comprehensive reform of even our constitutional order. A comprehensive reform. And I'm not imposing my views, these are just my views I've come to share with you. I don't believe, even though I'm a key player in the presidential system, I don't believe that the presidential system is what this country needs. It is too expensive, it is too wasteful, it easily lends itself to abuses, there are not enough checks, and above all, because you asked me to talk about productivity, the systems that we have created have not lent themselves to productivity. We cannot have a productive Nigeria the way it is structured. A Nigeria where the exclusive list is longer than the concurrent. A Nigeria where the federal government is a jack of all trades and a master of none. A Nigeria where the federal government maintains a ministry that builds petty things like even toilets and so on in communities. A Nigeria where the federal government, by so doing, anticipating itself in areas that it has no competence, no local knowledge to deliver productivity, anticipated itself to the extent that it has abandoned its core areas of responsibility. And what are these core areas of responsibility? Defense and national security, number one. Is anyone in this hall in any doubt as to whether the federal government has stood up to its primary responsibility of protecting Nigerians? No!
Not at all.
So that's a failure of responsibility. Yes, security is a digital court. But then, the constitutional structures and legal systems we have put in place in this country cannot deliver a safe and stable Nigeria. And that's why we're dealing with, as a sub-team, in this issue of restructuring. We talk about issues like devolution of powers and state police and so on. Now, I'm not here making a case for state police. What I'm saying is there is need for us to devolve policing powers, duties, and responsibilities closer to the people. What we need to do is to interact, crack our brains. There are very brilliant people. We are not all a nation of crooks, as some people have made us to be. We have enough people of goodwill to sit down and craft how this devolution of police powers should be. I have my own views. Take, for example, the issue of the judicature. By that I mean our systems of delivering justice. Why should they land disputes in my community, my small village in Torogua? And your village, for those of you who are from cities, even from your cities, why should a land dispute or a chieftaincy matter get to the Supreme Court of the Federal Republic of Nigeria? That is a recipe for unproductivity as a recipe for disaster, and that's why your systems are clogged up. So, as an essential element of the restructuring debate, we must look at the issue of how do we deliver justice in our cause. And right away, I'm a lawyer of over 25 years. And I've been Attorney General of my state, by Office Attorney General, went to the House of Reps, chaired the Justice Committee of the House of this country for quite some time. So I knew a thing or two when it comes to access to justice. The systems we have cannot deliver justice. And that's why, instead of the judiciary getting stronger, you see Babana was getting stronger. Because the human spirit is always yearning for justice. And now there's a frightening dimension. You have higher number of assassinations. There are so many distortions. Our systems have failed. Our institutions have failed. The distortion of the federal structure has destroyed and distorted our country. And this nation must move ahead. We must rise up and claim our destiny glory. And we can only do so when Nigeria is properly restructured. When our systems of government, our constitutional system and other, is reformed to unleash the potentials that are bound in this state. Every state in this country has enough mineral resources and enough talents to build on. And my dear friends, nations are not wealthy because they have oil and gas. The most important material, the most important resource is you and I, the human resource. And that's why you have nations doing so well and they don't have oil and gas. And for your information, for those who think in their comfort zones that this country will continue to live fat on the resources of the Niger Delta, very soon, I have bad news for you, but very soon, the oil and gas that has built your cities, that has created billionaires overnight without being productive, that resource will dry out very soon, or it will become worthless. So the sooner we go back to the essential founding principle, where this university, this great university, was not built with oil money. It was built by the sweat tears of the people from the Southwest region. People don't pay tax. The only people who manage to pay tax are civil servants. And those in the formal system, big companies and so on. Countries are run on taxes and other revenues. Legitimately more. That's why you can't have a legitimate economy. It's black market economy everywhere. Fuel subsidy, fraud, subsidizing fraud, creating emergency billionaires overnight with private jets and so on, money that's not accounted for, and a distortion of the systems. In our unbalanced federation, you are spending billions and billions, hundreds of billions, paying civil servants that have no work to do, the federal civil servants, no work to do. That is why we all need a restructuring mission. I'm from the Niger Delta. I know, as most of you also know, that the environment is gone in the Niger Delta, where we come from, where I come from. And the environment, for your information, is the collective heritage of all mankind. There's nothing like my other environment and Lagos environment. You may think it doesn't get to you, but the science of global warming and no respecter of persons. We have provoked the environment. Regulations are not working, judicial systems not working. And yet, these are all federal responsibilities. Standards are not obeyed. Producing companies comply with standards in their countries. When they come to Nigeria, Nigeria is a dumping ground. In Nigeria, of anything goes. Shakespeare said, hell had no fury comparable to that of a woman's coming. Sorry for the ladies here, I'm quoting Shakespeare. And I believe he was talking about the ladies of his time, not beautiful ladies now. But when Shakespeare took her life, and I'm talking about the man, he probably would have said, hell had no fury than the environment provoked. We have destroyed the environment of our people. In my place, our traditional livelihood is fishing. There are no more fishes to be caught. The few fishes there, they get as a bee. So, we now eat ice fish. And how do you get the money? A nation that has abandoned the oil producing areas for the past close to 60 years. Up till now, there has been no road to grass. We are trying to battle to get that road done. But you know the cost? Because of the terrain? Close to 200 billion naira. And yet, I don't control the resources that come from there. Even as we speak, they are taking oil from there. Even as we speak, no road to Focados. And that's another oil terminal. No road. No road to Bula, another terminal. And yet, that's where the wealth is coming from. So you guys don't understand, a number of you don't understand the challenges of development and the root causes of social instability. And since I became governor, we've been confronting these challenges. And the best way to re-engineer a new society is by investing in education. That was what the great government was doing. And that's why we are all here. There was not even a single boarding school in my state when I became governor in 2012. Our ranking on national exams was about 27, 28. And I declared an emergency in education. I want to commend my team, to commend the people of Bayelsa for understanding the revolution that I came to introduce. I thank and appreciate my good friends and Nigerians of goodwill who have encouraged and worked with me. Dr. Bumi, Chairman of the Governing Council, Professor Woloshenka, one of the great lights of this institution, J.P. Clark, and every other person who has encouraged me. Professor Shoika serves as my honorary advisor on education, honorary ambassador on education in my school. And as a result of this concerted push, we no longer have only one or two or even 10. We have built several boarding schools, now getting close to 30 and 40. And we have introduced, because it is an emergency, we have introduced compulsory boarding, compulsory, and it is free. Compulsory. Where we meet young boys and girls from their remote communities. Sometimes I have to threaten their parents to have access to them. We buy uniforms for all. We prepare, buy books for all of them. We feed them 3 times a day, free. And because it is something they are not used to, I have to enact the right to education law, prescribing punishment to any parent or other. And up till now, as I speak, in spite of my best endeavors, our schools still have a lot of vacancies. The chances have not been filled. And I'm still building schools. And I've introduced the education trust fund by law to make it mandatory for every person who earns a living in Bayelsa to contribute to that fund. From that fund, we are able to finance this revolutionary program of free education. And all these boarding schools are like tertiary institutions, the big facilities. The foremost one, the Joint National Academy, is like a university of its own. It has over 1,500 students, all free boarding students. That's the new Nigeria we are creating. And we have built one of the most successful health insurance systems. In a state where we didn't have functional healthcare facilities in local government areas, we now have one 60 to 80 bed hospital in every local government area. And we have world-class medical facilities. Last 2 months, General Obasanjo was there, President Obasanjo was there, commissioning the diagnostic center. And he called me 2 days ago, he will be in my examination for his medical. So I'm inviting all of you. I know that your facilities here are good, but the ones in Bayelsa are better. Now, we are building gigantic infrastructure connecting our people with roads and bridges, and an airport that is going to be the longest, apart from the one in Lagos, in southern Nigeria. All by our effort, and yet much more. My state has become safer and more stable than most states. Most of the things you hear and read about Bayelsa are not true. They belong to the Bayelsa of the past. The Bayelsa under me, the new Bayelsa, is safe, stable, prosperous, and ready for development. Now, I'm giving you a snippet of all of this just to let you know how much more I would have done if I had access to the revenues coming from my state. I'm tied down, I'm limited by whether a fact meeting holds or not. Fact meeting has not held for the past 1 week. I have to depend on an entity called NNPC. That is not transparent, that is the most opaque institution in the world. To dole out handouts to me, who is producing the resources of this country. And someone sits down there to work out a percentage and remits it to me and say that is 13%. Ladies and gentlemen, there's nothing like 13% derivation in Nigeria. It is not working. The 13% derivation stipulated in the Constitution is not respect, obey, it's not respected, it's not obeyed, it's not applied. What we get every month is what it pleases the almighty NNPC and the others in the federal system to dole out to us. So the way forward for this country is restructuring. Up to those who are killed every day, we now live in very interesting times. Times when the life of a human being does not have as much worth as that of the cow. In those days, in the Niger Delta, we know that oil has always been thicker than our blood. Oil has always been thicker than our blood. Operating companies and the collaborating Nigerian states don't care where we live or not. Don't care whether people go to school or not. Don't care whether our people die or not. But if you want security, if you don't want casualties arising from so-called herdsmen farmers clashes, and these are, there's something going on far more than that characterization. But that will be a story for another day. If you want stability and security, which only can be a foundation for development, then you need a restructured Nigeria. Where you, the people, at your local government levels, your community levels, at your state levels, and where you have regional affinity, as you do have in the Southwest, why not? We should talk of how to consider some regional mechanisms. We need a healthy debate to move our nation and our people forward. Our country has a lot of potentials, and we believe that in a united, strong Nigeria that we all cherish, This dream of restructuring is what would be the founding principle, just as our father's permission to be. I want to thank you all for being here. I congratulate the Vice Chancellor. I thank the Dean, and I appreciate the Dean and the faculty members for their work. And I don't take this honor lightly. Like I said, for me, who started life not the way a number of my young friends here are doing, who have the privilege of coming attending OAU, I started life as a police constable. My very poor background, by dint of hard work, by God's mercies, we are playing the role that we are playing. It is possible for any of you. Possible. But this Nigeria, in which all of that will be possible, is a Nigeria that can guarantee peace and stability and equity for all. I want to thank my members of the delegation, who are great former students of this institution. The silence of David Dokbo, my immediate former Secretary of Government, Commissioner Fukase Cruz, ABC Young Brown, my Deputy Chief of Staff, and Bello, who is also part of my team, the SA Media, Fidelis, and all of that. I want to thank particularly my good friend and colleague in the struggle, Comrade Okumai, the great old boy of this institution. Thank you for coming with me. And Professor Adedoja, another great alumni, former minister, Madam Patti, who also graduated here. The young people, the students of the state, thank you very much. And the faculty members, thank you for being here. And the young people. Yeah.